This morning, I'm going to share with you what it's going to take for us to accomplish as a church and God's people the task that God has called us to. If we don't understand this principle in this part of the will of God, we will not be able to fulfill the call of God. Is that plain enough? It's something that all of the apostles, every man and woman of the Bible, has had to come to terms with. You got it? And the task that's ahead of us, it's a big one. Do you notice what that sign says? We've got the spirit of 300 men that fought with Gideon. How many of you know the story of Gideon? The story of Gideon is a very unique story because God literally says that you have too many people. Did you understand that? And God cuts the group down from thousands down to 300. God's math is a math that every equation in God's math gives him all the glory. Did you get that? If the scripture would have said Gideon had 300,000 men, it wouldn't have been God's math. Because in God's math, people have to understand that his equation is this. Beyond the shadow of a doubt, you have to know that I was in charge of this and that this was impossible for you to do. The story starts out with thousands and thousands, and God says, you have too many. We're going to war. Oh, you got too many. And God whittles it down to 300 people. We are living this. A group your size, and notice that I'm saying you guys. Yesterday, Saturday, you passed out food to four different apartment complexes. One of them is right next to one another, so it's one drop-off, right? And another ministry was supplied with 7 tons of food because they were having an event, and it was a bunch of different groups together. It was through the Mayor's Faith Initiative. So yesterday, it was 5 events. Did you get that? We've been averaging 13 tons of food every Saturday being passed out. So we average 13 tons. The smallest that we give is 8 tons. Yeah, 8 tons. So every Saturday, minimum 8 tons, but the average is 13 tons. With a group this size. Did you get that? We do not have thousands of people that go to this church. Now, if you add our churches in India, which, by the way, I received, it's hard not to cry, but the churches in India, you know how the term that we use nowadays, well, they're under our covering. Well, when I mean they're under our covering, they mean under Jesus' covering first, and then our covering, all of us. And literally, and I want you to understand this is the ministry that God has put upon us and we have received. Not only is this going on here in Las Vegas at Feeding People, but the churches in India literally send their word, and this was their word: if it wasn't for you guys supporting us, we would be starving to death. The situation in India has been the worst in the world with this COVID deal. Our people over there are telling us that in the night time, I don't know if you saw some of the news last week, that as you look toward the outside of the towns and cities, that you see the red glow, and those are the bodies being burned. Did you understand that? But they said, please tell the people there in Las Vegas that if it wasn't for them, we would be starving to death. We're going to be showing you the latest pictures of all the people that are receiving food and so forth. Jesus is the one, you know, this is what I told him. I told him, Jesus is blessing us so we can bless you. See, you are the reason why. And the reason that we're able to pass out so much in our area, command and do this stuff, is guess what? It's because of them. Remember, God uses you for them. Whenever God gives you something, it's for them. Did you understand that? I have never been a pastor of a congregation like you guys. You are just mind-boggling. Mind-boggling. We do not know if we're going to distribute food this coming week, this coming Saturday. Right now, we're in the process of doing this paperwork. So it looks like it's going to be handed over to us, but it's about us being a main distribution center. That means 2.5 truck and trailer loads, you know, the 18-wheelers. I was told possibly twice a week. I've already been contacting organizations and churches. I want you to pray. There's this one group, it's 120 of them, for them to want to take the responsibility and get their people to help us get this food to the community. Did you get that? And it might only be once a week, but two and a half 18-wheeler load once a week is. Now, if you do not know what it is to go hungry, then this is no big deal. It might just be, oh, just another commercial or another thing of volunteering. But I remember, before I came to America, I lived in a communist country, Cuba. And I remember the lines for you to get food. Trust me, we don't know what a line is here. A line was, you better bring water. You know, because you'll be there a long time. So you can just grab a few things. What God has put into our hands, it's amazing. But we're waiting for this okay. You got it? So we're going to find out this week. I mean, what you've been doing is incredible. Now, I want you to listen to this. That will be easier to do because the trucks will be driving up on the property, and you saw our new forklift. Well, this is just a borrow. They're letting us use this one because ours is being completely gone through, the new one, and it holds more than this. It goes higher. I mean, we're going to need it anyway. So we have that. Then we have a retreat center. That's in the workings right now. You got it? We should be signing papers within the next 7 days. Then I was told the latest mid-July, and it looks real good because we've passed three tests. We got 100% on all three of them to receive a very large amount of money, millions, to build a facility here in town where we're going to have our own refrigeration area. Do you have no idea how much food we turn away because we do not have a way to keep it cold? You got it? And that facility will be a facility designed to work with our partners that work with us, you know, all the different nonprofits, when we put, you know, the big events. But we want it to be a place that when you walk in the front door, you walk up to the receptionist, and she'll say, "How can I help you?" And they'll say, "I have drug problems, I have gambling problems, a crisis in my marriage." You get where I'm coming from? I need medical assistance. And all the receptionist will have to say, "Go to door number 2 for this, go to door number 5 for that." We're going to have a special room for intercessory for prayer only. Our dream has been 24-hour prayer. An outside door with combination where only the intercessors will have a combination to get into that room. When you walk in that room, they'll be talking about nothing but what you're going to pray about, intercessory. Because you want the glory of God to flow through all the counseling and everything. And we're going to have a sanctuary. You got it? But the focus is going to be not just on the sanctuary, but what happens during the week. You get it? I don't know about you, but if you look at Jesus' life, he went on and did all kinds of stuff for 6 days. Then on Sunday, he went to the temple. But for 6 days, he was out there among the people, helping them. With a group this size. In the second service. But I want you to start praying for laborers. Because we literally are finding ourselves in the Bible, not just some 300 men that fought with Gideon. By the way, we have 300 dudes and 300 chicks here. But we're also finding ourselves in a position that Jesus found himself in where he said, "Look at that harvest. We don't have enough to gather them." And he looked at the harvest and he said, "They're like sheep without a shepherd." You know who the shepherd was, right? The one that was talking. "They're like sheep without me," Well, it's what Jesus was saying. Now, to do this, it's going to take God, and that's what this is about. I remember when I was in business and we first started Christian Cabinet Company, we started the company with, you're going to laugh at this, my income tax return check. It was a walloping fortune. It was just a little over $300. In a single car garage. Not two. We had to grow to the two. And I remember that each level took more trusting in God. I remember the first time we ordered from Georgia Pacific, that's one of the biggest lumber companies, our first truck and trailer load, an 18-wheeler full of lumber. Let me tell you something. We made sure that we ordered the right size. This is going to do this many cabinets. It was the first 18-wheelers full of lumber. I remember the first job, our big job. It was over 300 kitchens at the same time, just one project. That was kitchen, bathroom, vanities. Those are the cabinets in your bathrooms. The closet poles, shelves, all the trim in the house. And it seemed like, oh my gosh, we've never done anything like this. We really have to trust God. You that are in business, you're going to face that. You're going to face a beautiful opportunity. Mr. Fred, all of you, of having an opportunity to know how big God is. I remember a $300 job, about $30 tithe. I remember when I looked at Earl Owens, my partner, and I remember one job, this one job came in. It was over $300,000, and I said, Earl, the tithe on this will be over $30,000. And I had a good partner because, we were just for real with one another, and I said, boy, it was easy to tithe $30. Now we're giving up some Corvettes here and stuff, what I'm saying? This is like, and we laughed, but we made Jesus our head CEO. You see that chair right there? No one sits on that chair but the presence of God. It's a red chair, the only red chair we have in the sanctuary. It says, reserved for Jesus Christ our Lord. When we started Christian Covenant Company, it was just like that. That's how real. He's in the meeting. You gotta take it serious. God will take you real serious. But here we are. So we're going to find out, how is God going to make it able for us to do all this stuff? You got it? Some of you are going to be working full-time in the future in the ministry here. Salaries, the whole deal. I want you to listen to this. Because this is what got me through Christian Cabinet Company when I had to believe God, me and my partner, for miracles. You know what our first table saw was? How many of you know what a table saw is? Basically, it's a metal table with a blade that comes up, and you cut wood on it. The blade goes up and down, and it goes in angles. We made it out of wood. We made the table out of wood. And how many of you know what a 7 1/4 skill saw is? It's a saw that you use for framing and cutting wood. And you know what we did? We made a table out of wood, cut a slot, took a hand saw, electric saw, we screwed it upside down, the blade would go up and down, and it turned degrees, and that was our first table saw. That was creative. The wood, what kept the wood from, you know, not cutting like this, was two clamps with a piece of aluminum angle. Now, when our own truck was going out to the job site, and by the way, our truck in the business was dark blue, and it had silver writings on the side. You know what it said? Jesus is Lord, Jesus is coming. When we would come to a job site to deliver our products, you know, trucks like, Mike, like the one that you have, it said Jesus all over it, you know. Now, we did that because that's what the Lord led us to do. God has not led everybody to do that. But you should have seen it. When we were pulling the job site, every carpenter, every plumber, everybody would just see that truck with all that stuff about Jesus. What in the world is this? But I remember when we had to build a wood table and screw a handsaw underneath. Now I was driving a Corvette to the job site. I remember one guy, he was older than me. Now I'm the older guy. And he talked about me being young and coming up to the job site, you know, on a Corvette. He didn't think I knew anything about the trade. Baby, we had brought that company up from ground zero. We knew our stuff because God expects you. He puts you in something, He expects you to know. So I got persecuted for that, being too young and driving a Corvette. But they didn't see me when I was driving a car that was $75, that had worn out seated and had a spring that it would strategically attack you and hit you on the right kidney. When you less expected it, because I would shove a beach towel into the back. They didn't see that. Did you understand that? But they worked for me. They thought I was just some young guy that had inherited or whatever, you know. Don't let critics ever stop you. You enjoy the blessing of God when it comes to you. Amen? And enjoy the fellowship with Him when you have nothing. If you enjoy God when you have nothing, then you'll enjoy Him when you have something the right way. Hallelujah. I am proud of you guys. I'm happy to serve with you. You know, when I was in the Marine Corps, I loved our group. We had a group of 20. I was so proud of those guys. They were, you know, we were just... And this is beyond that. So I just want to compliment you, but here we go. You are the factory of the work of God. If you don't produce it, it doesn't happen. How did the food boxes get out there to the people? You were the factory. Did you get that? Jesus said, greater works than these you will do because I go unto my Father. In other words, when I go to my Father, you're going to be able to do more than... Do you know that you guys have fed over 5,000 people? Only because he went to what? He's still the head, huh? You have fed way over 5,000 people. I love it when I find myself in the Word. Find yourself in the Word and you'll get the results. Listen, if you find yourself in the work of God and in the Word of God, the miracle will find you. But see, the miracle is in the Word. And when you look at your circumstances and they're in the Word, you're also in the place where the miracle happened. Time and space with God is very unique. All of this is still existing. You just have to step into your Holy Spirit time machine and step into when God said it. You're a time traveler, baby. And you'll get the same results. Here we go. One of the famous scriptures we quote all the time. Then he answered and spoke unto me, saying, this is the word of the Lord unto Zerubbabel. This guy was in an impossible situation. Here's God's answer. Saying, not by might nor by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord of hosts. It's not by your power. It's not by anybody's might, but it's by my Spirit. Do you know that God created the heavens and the earth by his Spirit? Do you know that the Bible says that the Spirit of God, the Word was spoken, and the Spirit of God brought it into existence? Do you know who brings miracles into existence, healings and so forth? The Holy Spirit. That's why they're called the gifts of the Spirit, and every gift of the Spirit is what? It's a miracle. He's called the Spirit of life. What does that mean? He brings life to what you've read about God. And it becomes alive right now. That's why he's called the Spirit of life. Says the Lord of hosts. Notice how he finishes with hosts. You know what that means? The Lord of good angels and bad angels. Good people, bad people. The Lord of everything. Next verse, Acts 1:8. These are the last words that Jesus spoke before he left planet Earth. Do you think that might be important? Okay. The last words before he left. But ye shall receive power. But ye shall receive power after the Holy Ghost is come upon you. Why is he called the Holy Spirit in one place and the Holy Ghost in another? Because when he is described as the Holy Ghost, it means the ghost of Jesus. To haunt the devil. He's here. The Holy Ghost is Jesus' ghost, the Holy Spirit, here haunting and striking terror into everything that's evil. Even the old you. Even the old Jose. That bad part of you is terrified of Jesus. Because that bad part of you knows that Jesus is a killer. Jesus will kill the bad side of you. So the new born again you will blossom into being like Jesus. My God, my God. Salvation is an exchange program. Don't ever forget that. The Bible says that he became sin for us that we might become the what? Righteousness of God. What is that? An exchange program. We don't do things. We don't do things to feel an approval from God. And if I do X amount of things, then I feel better about myself. No. Don't get caught in that trap. We exchange. I exchange my sins for his righteousness. That's what repentance does. That's why repenting is so important. I repent of this. Now, I give it to him, and then he gives me his righteousness. Did you get that? That's a principle that follows everything. I don't know if you've noticed. Even tithing, watch. I give him 10%, and what does he give me? It's an exchange. Everything is an exchange. Works is of yourself and yourself only. You're just religious. The reason we do the things we do is because we love him and the people. And we exchange our time on the weekends. You do. So they can find comfort and peace and hope. We exchange their misery for a spark of hope. Last things Jesus said before he left the planet, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me. You know what that means? You're going to witness to people. Just like somebody does before a jury, that Jesus is who he is. He is who he says he is. You tell them about him when we're passing out that food, but you also have action. Faith without works is dead. Let me tell you something, your faith is not dead. Hallelujah. Both in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and into all the uttermost parts of the earth. That's Las Vegas, the uttermost part. People come to Las Vegas from all over the world to sin. Why do you think it's called sin? They nicknamed it Sin City. They come from all over the world to sin here. But you know that's a lie, right? All it is a trap that God has set up. It's the bait. Sin City. If you're watching over there, come to Sin City. Because what you do in Vegas is going to stay in Vegas. You know what that means to us as Christians? What you do in Vegas, the blood of Jesus will destroy in Vegas. You'll be forgiven. And it won't go outside anywhere else. Pretty important, huh? He's going to give you power to do it. And guess what the next verse is? And when he had spoke these things, while they beheld, he was taken up in a cloud, received him out of their sight. Last things he said. Hallelujah. Next verse, Ephesians 3:16. That he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man. That's what the Holy Spirit does. There's a strength that happens inside of you. What do you mean inside of you? You will what he wills. You have that compassion for them like he has. He gives you that. We need that. Guess who does it? He does. That's why it's not by part of my body, but by my spirit, says the Lord. That he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might by his spirit in the inner man. The inner you. See, this is a machine. Nerves, muscles. But what's inside? He strengthens. Next verse. Colossians 1:11. Strengthened with all might. What? There it is again. Strengthened with what? All might. That means every might that God has. He's pretty mighty, you know. According to his glorious power. That's why we've been able to do the size we are. That's why we've been able to do what we've done, and nobody's burned out. On the contrary, we're lit up. Unto all patience and long-suffering with joyfulness. It gets hot out there. But the joyfulness. You know, Mike is really quick, you know, because he, you know, I don't want to even embarrass ourselves, but he knows what he's doing when it comes to loading and unloading the trucks. But it gets hot when you're moving those pallets because you have to get it from the front of the truck all the way to the back before the forklift or the gate that goes up the hydraulic gate brings it down. You get that? And for you to help the people get them and stuff. Are you ready for some good news? Strengthened with all might according to his glorious power. God literally takes, you know how Jesus took his blood and he shed it for you and he tells you to drink it, you know, communion and eat his body. Do you know that his power is the same way? It goes, his power goes into your inner man. Unto all patience and long suffering with joyfulness. That's why when you're out there and it's hot and you're doing all of this and stuff, yeah, there's some suffering involved, but you're also very happy when you see those people, huh? Listen to this. Ephesians 2:10. For we are his workmanship. You know who the work of the Lord is? The work of the Lord is you. Because you're the work of the Lord. That's why the work of the Lord goes out. See, the work of the Lord has 2 feet. Hands. I can say that you guys and anybody that's doing things for Jesus is the work of God. Your first name is Christians. That means little anointed ones. Your last name is, I'm the work of the Lord. Work of the Lord isn't what you do out there. You are the work of the Lord. That's why it happens out there. That's why faith without works is dead. Because it's not the work of the Lord. It's not doing anything. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works. See, God's done such a work in you that you go out and you do what Jesus did. The exchange program. Hallelujah. Which God has before ordained that we should walk in them. You know, God ordained for you to walk into what we're reading right now. You're doing it. You know what a blessing it is to stand in front of a congregation and say you're doing it instead of, well, you know, you gotta, and you know, get off of your hinder parts. I didn't cuss. I said hinder parts. That's in the Bible. This is a much better, I feel a lot better preaching about this. Hallelujah. Philippians 2:13. For it is God which worketh in you. You're possessed. And no one's going to cast him out. He's in you. Never mind demon possession. You're God possessed. That's the answer to demon possession. For it is God which worketh in you both. That means two things. So what is he working in you? To will and to do of his good pleasure. To what? To will. Listen. God's will. God has a way of putting his will inside of you. And then his will starts acting out of you. And you know what he acts like? Himself. Who does God act like? Himself. He can't act like nobody else. He already has the top role. Finishing it up. 2 Corinthians 12:9. Who does it? You are his workmanship. He does. Start trusting that God. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That, he really means that. You're possessed. The work at the cross means that Jesus was creating you. That's why you are a new creation. Second Corinthians 12:9. And he said unto me, my strength is, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. You know the weakest part of your life? Don't worry, God's got it covered. God says that where you're the weakest, he says, oh no, that you don't understand. That's the throne of my power. See, it says, made perfect in us. He's already perfect in himself. But what he does with us is the biggest miracle. Because anybody can say, well, God is perfect in himself. His power is perfect in himself. But he's so big that he can come along and he can say, I'm going to show you how big I am. All my strength is going to be made perfect in you. In the area that you are the weakest. My throne, honey, is right there. We're going to rock it. It's not by might nor by power, but by my spirit. Do this. You just hug the Holy Spirit. He's in you. Hallelujah. For my strength is made perfect in weakness. More gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities and my weakness. Ha! Right here, this place of weakness. I'm so happy that this is where God's power sits in the throne of my weakness. Will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me? You know what that means? Rest. Watch. Cameras, watch this. The Holy Spirit just rests on you. Says, well, I found a place that I can just relax and be myself and be powerful. My power can rest upon this factory. I have my chair at home. When I sit in there, I'm resting. I hit a button and the feet go up, the back does this, the head does this, all that other stuff. I only paid $55 for it. Brand new. Hallelujah. Awesome. I feel like I'm, you know, on a Learjet or something. But there it is. Let it rest upon you. Rest upon what? Why is it rest? Rest. Exchange your weakness for His power. He's the one. Faith is this. I'm resting because God is doing it. I can't do it, but God is doing it. Last verse. Are you ready? I love this verse. Job 17:9. How many of you know that he knew a few things? Are you ready? Job 17:9. The righteous shall move onward and forward. This is in the King James. I'm reading you another translation. The righteous shall move onward and forward. Turn to your neighbor and say, he's talking about us. Those with pure hearts shall become stronger and stronger. Do you know, I got to tell you this. I got to tell you a secret that I learned that's happening in all of us. Watch this. Let's say here's Mike's biggest weakness. He just got saved and here's his biggest weakness. Got it? God's strength is made perfect in that area. You know what God does after that? He goes find another weakness so that can be strengthened. That's why I used to love cocaine, folks. I mean, you know what I mean when I say love? I mean agape. And that's like the God type of love. That was my God. You got it? And that weakness, His power rested upon it. Let me tell you something. I am not kidding you. I have had cocaine put in front of me, and I want to throw up. And then you know what the Lord did when He got done with that, Mike? He said, oh, look at that weakness over there. He goes over there and rests upon it. And that's what's been happening. It's called sanctification to all of us. That's why we're changing. Some areas take longer than others, but guess what? Just speak to that area and say, don't worry. His strength is coming to be made perfect in you. Your times are coming. Time's ticking. You're on death row. So people of God, go forth, be bold, be strong, for the Lord thy God is with thee. We're going to accomplish everything that we need to accomplish. Why? Him. In Him we move and live and breathe and have our being. That's a scripture. Glory to God. Now the next group's coming in. So God bless you. May the Holy Spirit possess you and haunt you with His peace. You walk into a dark room, ladies or men or little kids, and it's dark. Instead of going, oh, there's an evil thing in here, whatever, just go, this place is haunted by the Holy Ghost. There is a ghost here. You ready? God bless you. God bless you. Read those verses.